Само, че при...
Само, че аз започнах да записвам още докато виждаме твоя имейл.
Да.
Сега ти виждаме текст едите. Просто друг скрин сложи.
Да, да, сложи. Сега виждате ли каквото трябва?
Да, виждаме Катя.
Значи нещо е wrong.
Окей. Кажете кога мога да започвам.
Окей, before to start, welcome to everybody here. There are two or three persons from abroad, so we should speak in English. You see, we have some small reason for a small celebration, because the 1st of March, 10 years ago, the section of algebra and the section of mathematical logics were started its cooperation, their cooperation as a new section of algebra, department of algebra and logic. Of course, these 10 years together, this is not the beginning of the algebra and the logic at the institute, because the department of algebra was founded in 1951, 70 years ago. The department of mathematical logic was a little bit younger. It was founded 62 years ago, but for these 10 years which were in which we are together, our seminar works quite regularly. For example, a small statistic shows that today this is meeting number 135. And the number of the talks, this is 263. The number of the talks is bigger because once a year you will have a meeting where all the people of the department have some reports. Separately, we organized for these meetings, we have speakers from more than 20 countries, starting from Bulgaria, reaching Korea and China. And of course, from Brazil, United States, etc. So all over the world. And separately, we made two more meetings, conferences which were greater. Grita, this is not a female name. This is an abbreviation for groups and drinks, theory and applications, with about more than 100 talks there. And separately, of course, one of these meetings was a satellite event of the European Congress of Mathematicians. And it was organized together of our institute, the Moscow State University, the Memorial University of Newfoundland, in the University of Brasilia, because we celebrated the anniversary of Bakhturin, who was the advisor of me and of Petrogradsky, who is now here, one of the participants. Also, we participated in two more meetings, very big meetings, Mathematics Days in Sofia, with more than 40 talks there. So altogether, we had somewhere about 415 talks or even more. But now, this is, I want to present the next speaker today. This is Dessislava Kochloukova from Campinas, Brazil. Okay, she is Bulgarian. She got her master here in Sofia, the University of Sofia, then a PhD in Cambridge, UK. And now she is professor in Brazil, and she is the first Bulgarian mathematician who was elected for a member of the Brazilian Academy of Sciences. I'm not sure whether there are other Bulgarians who are non-mathematicians and are members of the Academy, but in any case, she's maybe the first also in this direction. So this, you have the talk, please.
Okay, thank you very much. First of all,
can I please ask a quick question? Desi, could you please enlarge it, zoom it a little bit?
Okay, just thank a you. Moment. Is that okay?
Yes, that's fine.
Okay. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers of the seminar for the opportunity to speak. My main field of research is group theory, but what I'm going to talk today is a mixture between groups, Lie algebras and restricted Lie algebras. Though, as I said, my main field of research is group theory, in the last few years I've been interested in Lie algebras. And not only in the last few years, right? But I've been done some work in this direction in the last few years. So today we're going to talk about grouply algebras and restrictedly algebras. What is interesting in these three categories, we have the notion of a free object. A free object F in one of these three categories comes with a basis X, which is a subset of the free object F. And it comes with a universal property, a very basic and standard one everybody has seen, I'm sure, about this. If you have a set theoretic map from your basis X to any object in your category, then there exists a unique morphism from the free object to your fixed object M. Another important property is finite presentability. And when we talk about finite presentability, we mean about finite presentability in terms of generators and relations. It's a very natural property when you work with groups, and probably it's much less studied for Lie algebras and restricted Lie algebras. We try to present an object in our category in terms of generators X and relators R, which means the following. We have a short exact sequence in our category starting from a free object F with a basis X. Having a short exact sequence with right corner M, it means that Fx to M is an epimorphism and N is the kernel of this epimorphism. And the set of relations R that defines our object M is actually a subset of N with the following property. For any other kernel of epimorphism from the free object F to S, let's call this kernel T. If R is inside of T, then N inside of T. But this is the natural property we know about presenting groups, Lie algebras or restricted Lie algebras in terms of generators and relations. And an object is presented if it exists a presentation where both generators and relations are finitely many. So everything was quite general by now, but actually today I'm going to discuss all these three categories, but I'm going to focus on a metabelian object. What is a metabelian object? I mean, an object is metabelian if there is a short exact sequence in the category which A and Q, where A and Q are abelian. And our aim is to discuss finite presentability of metabelian objects in any of these categories. So first I'm going to move now and talk only about groups, and then I'll move to Lie algebras and restricted Lie algebras. Well, the first example of a finitely presented group is the obvious one. We start with a free group with a finite basis X, and this is finitely presented because it has no relations. Another very easy and obvious example is the case of finitely generated abelian groups. They're finitely presented, and it falls from the classification of finitely generated abelian groups. They are direct sums of copy of Zn plus some finite abelian group. Another example of finitely presented group is a polycyclic group. What is a polycyclic group? A group is polycyclic if it has a chain of subnormal subgroups such that each subgroup is normal in the bigger one, and every quotient in this filtration is cyclic. It might be infinite cyclic, it might be finite, it doesn't matter. That's the definition of a polycyclic group. Polycyclic groups are finitely presented. And these three examples are very easy examples. They are all examples of finitely presented groups. And now we come to our first example of a group which is actually metabelian, but it's not finitely presented. So we take the free group with the basis X. X is finite, bigger than one. It has more than one element. And then we consider the free metabelian group with the basis X. What is this? We take the free group, then we consider the derived subgroup, and then we consider the derived subgroup of the derived subgroup, which here is written with F dash dash, and then we quotient. So this is the free object in the category of metabelian groups, but it's not free group as a group. And this one is not finitely presented. Okay, I'm going to tell you a bit later on why this is not finitely presented using one very big criterion, but actually it's been known for quite some time this is not finitely presented. And again, this is not a difficult example. And then we come to another example. Now we have the following group. We have a group G, which is the following. We take the ring Z 1 over 6. So we take all rational numbers where the denominators have elements which are divisible by powers of 2 and 3. So this is a ring. And we take one copy of infinite cyclic group Z and we take T as a generator. Then we cook up from these two abelian groups. Right, we cook another group, which is the semi-direct product. We have to say how the generator of the infinite cyclic group Z acts on the bottom by conjugation. And in the first case, the action is by multiplication with 2/3. And in that case, the group is not finitely presented. And in the second case, conjugation is given by multiplication with 1/6, we get another group. And in this case, the group is finitely presented. So we've seen several examples, but without much explanations. Actually, these examples are not very complicated. But to get to the general case, we need a bit of notation. So here, G is a finitely generated metabelian group. And we have an epimorphism from G to Q, where Q is abelian, and A is the kernel of this epimorphism, and it's abelian. So the first point is that we can view A as a module over the group algebra of Q. To have a module, we need two structures. We need a sum, and with an action by Q. The operation sum is induced by the group operation in G. It might be confusing at first sight, but G is a metabelian object. It's a metabelian group. It's not abelian. So we write the product there multiplicatively. But when you restrict it down to A, we move the notation and start writing the group operation as sum. And the action of Q on A is the only, here we fix action on the right, is the only one natural action that exists in the group here, and that's conjugation. Which means that if you take A from the kernel A and Q from the Q, we have to leave Q to an element G of G. And the action of Q on A is actually conjugation on the right on A with the element G. And here the situation is very general. What I assume by now only is that G is finitely generated metabelian. And that's it. And now, in this context, Q is finitely generated abelian, hence is finitely presented. Just a moment. Sorry about that. So, Q is finitely presented, and this forces A to be finitely generated as a Q module. Now, the group algebra of Q over the integers is a Noetherian commutative ring. Actually, this is the ring of Lorentz polynomials, and it's a quotient of a polynomial ring with coefficients in Z. So it's Noetherian. And as A is finitely generated, A is a Noetherian module over ZQ. And as I said, we're in a very general situation, but actually this little remark tells you that commutative algebra might be very useful in this context, and actually that's what happens. Now, I want to explain you a theory which is due to Bieri and Strebel, and it classifies all finitely presented metabelian groups. The stuff I'm going to explain now comes from that paper, which is an old paper. It's from 40 years ago, but it's a fundamental paper. It's a very beautiful paper. And it, at the time it was published, it was a huge surprise. At the time I was 10 years old, and probably, I mean, though I was interested in mathematics, I didn't know any real mathematics, right? I read this many years later, but even later I couldn't greatly enjoy this paper. And you see, this paper, not only it comes with a new criterion, it comes with several surprises. And the first big surprise is that the criterion that's presented there for finite presentability implies that the finite presentability of a metabelian group G, which is in the middle of a short exact sequence and A and Q on the ends, actually doesn't depend on the type of the extension, right? I mean, if we're given two groups, then the group in the middle is not uniquely defined, even if we know the both groups and we know the action of the top group on the bottom by conjugation. To define the group in the middle, you have to know the type of the extension, and it's completely determined by some second cohomology, so by the elements of H2Q with coefficients in A. And the biggest surprise of all is that in that particular class, in the class of finitely presented groups, the type of extension doesn't matter, right? And the second big surprise, probably it's not a surprise, but if you algebraize, the surprise is that the proofs and the methods, at least 50% of the method used in this paper, come from algebraic topology. For the people that do geometric group theory and are more accustomed with finite presentability, probably this is not a surprise, because being finitely presented is a topological and geometric property. Though you can describe it in the language of algebraic language, sometimes for complicated groups, the methods that are used naturally come from geometry, because you draw diagrams and study homotopical times in low dimension of spaces, right? So algebraic topology, it's not such a big, the use of algebraic topology is not such a big surprise. To explain the theory, I'll need to explain what a character sphere is, and it's a very, very simple notion. You take a finitely generated abelian group Q, and you consider all homomorphisms from Q to R. You view Q with multiplicative, the operation Q is multiplicative, and in R is additive. And then, since Q is a direct sum of copy of Zn plus a finite abelian group, and R is torsion free, so there are no non-trivial homomorphism from T to R, then all homomorphisms from Q to R are nothing less than all homomorphisms from Zn to R. And this is Rn, which is the n-dimensional Euclidean space. So this object is not mysterious at all. And now we say that two homomorphisms, two characters, they're called characters, are equivalent if one of them is obtained from the other by multiplication with a positive real number. There are versions of these results that don't use this equivalence. I mean, this is done just for aesthetic reasons, to say. And then bracket sky is the equivalent class of your character. Character here is a homomorphism, non-zero homomorphism. So the character sphere is the set of all equivalence classes of non-zero characters. We already saw that all homomorphisms, all characters represent the elements of the Euclidean space. So taking out the trivial one, which is the origin of the plane, and then squashing each line to a point, because one line represents the classes that equivalent, we get the unit sphere. Basically, you can take the array and intersect it with the unit sphere. So you can, there is a natural bijection between the character sphere and the unit sphere. And finally, for every non-zero character, we defined a submonoid of the abelian group Q, which is the non negative elements under the action of the character. This is a submonoid, and ZQ chi is a subring of the group algebra. So finally, we can define the Bieri-Strebel invariant. The Bieri-Strebel invariant is the set of all equivalence classes of characters, so all the elements of the character sphere, for which A is finitely generated as a module over this subring ZQ chi. We saw in the previous slide that A is always in this context finitely generated as a module over the group algebra, over the ZQ. But it doesn't tell you anything about a subring quasi ZQ chi. In general, this is a very general setting. I mean, this property might hold or might not hold. In this paper by Bieri Strebel, part of the paper, they study some properties of this sigma invariant and how it respects submodules and others. So, I mean, you can develop some general theory and study this invariant. But what turns out that actually to study this invariant, you need only methods from commutative algebra, and it was done a few years later in a paper by Bieri and Groves, which was published in the Crelli Journal of Maths. In that paper, Bieri and Groves showed a link between the points in the character sphere that outside of the sigma invariant and valuation theory from commutative algebra. And they showed that the complement of the sigma invariant is actually a rationally defined polyhedral. Has a rationally defined polyhedral structure. I'm not going to tell exactly what this means, but as a corollary, rational points there are dense. It is interesting to note that later on, this result that uses valuation theory was used in tropical geometry, and it's one of the papers by Bieri and Groves that is a lot of, has more than 100 citations. So now we come to the criterion. I promise you a criterion that says one, a finitely generated metabelian group is finitely presented. So here comes the Bieri-Strebel criterion. It says the following: if we have a finitely generated metabelian group, then it's finitely presented if and only if the complement of the sigma invariant does not contain antipodal points. And I want to go back through the example, some of the examples we've seen in view of this theorem. For example, in the case of a relatively free example, when we have F the free group with the basis X, and then we just quotient the second derived subgroup. This is our group G. In that case, Q is going to be a debilization of F, and A is going to be a debilization of the derived subgroup of F. In this case, it's very easy to calculate and see that sigma A of Q is the empty set. So the complement of the sigma is the whole character sphere. So it has antipodal points. So G is not finitely presented. Okay, actually that example was well known and understood much before the Bieri-Strebel theory came, but it's one illustration that really this criterion works. And I'm going to show you what happens with the other example when we have the ring Z 1 over 6, and then we have split extension with infinite cyclic group, which has generator T. In this case, we take Q to be the cyclic infinite cyclic group with generator T. A is going to be the ring Z when we invert 6. And as Q is cyclic infinite, then SSQ has 2 points, antipodal. It corresponds to 2 characters, chi1 and chi2. Chi1 sends t to 1 and chi2 sends t to minus 1. So what happens in this case? When t acts via conjugation by multiplication with tutors. In this case, Q chi 1 is the submonoid of Q, which takes only positive powers of T, or T equals to 0. So Z Q chi 1 is the ring over Z generated by 2/3. And then if we have the antipodal character chi 2, then Z Q chi 2 is Z, and we take a generator 3 over 2. But in both cases, our ring A is not finitely generated over these rings. Okay, because in the denominators, we need sufficiently big powers of 2 and 3. And in the one of the cases, we get sufficiently many powers of 3 or 2, but not both. So sigma is the empty set. Then the complement of sigma in the character sphere is the whole character sphere. It has antipodal points, and using the criterion G is not finitely presented. And now the situation changes when we move the group. Now we have a different metabelian group when the action of the generator T is multiplication by 1/6. In that case, in the first case, if we calculate the ZQ chi 2, then in this case, this is the ring over Z generated by 6, so this is Z, and A is not finitely generated over Z because it's not finitely generated as a Abelian group. So in this case, chi 2, the class of it, represents an element which is outside sigma. But if we look at the other character, which is chi 1, then ZQ chi 1 is the ring generated over Z by 1/6. And A, this is actually the whole A, so A is finitely generated over this ring. So chi 1 represents an element of sigma. So the complement then contains only one point. So this complement does not contain antipodal points, and the group G is finitely present. Actually, there are other ways to see how this criterion is used. I mean, for the examples I've done, it's possible to cook other reasons and prove it without using Bieri-Strebel criterion, which is doesn't have an easy proof. But I wanted to point out how this is used. And then a natural question that arises, how easy it's calculate the sigma, and in general, it's difficult. You have to really understand well how to calculate valuations. The surprise that was proved in the same paper by Bieri Strebel is the following result. If G is finitely presented group that does not contain non-cyclic free subgroups, then the maximal metabelian quotient of G is finitely presented. Actually, it's very, very shocking because finite presentability is not a property that you expect to be preserved by quotients. In general, if I give you a finitely presented group and then quotient it, then probably, depending on the group, obviously, in the situation, but most quotient is not going to be finitely presented, right? The proof of this result uses methods from algebraic topology covering maps. And it's a very beautiful proof. And it doesn't use complicated algebraic topology. Actually, I've made a master student write a master, her master thesis, writing that part of the argument. And along the way, the student had to learn basic algebraic topology. But it's a very nice application how basic algebraic topology can be applied to get very nice results. The requirement that G shouldn't contain free objects, non-cyclic free objects, is obviously necessary because this result doesn't hold if the original group G is a free object of rank bigger than one. Obviously, we already discussed it. F over the second derived subgroup is not finitely presented. And then you can ask, okay, we can say something about maximal metabelian quotient, but can we say something more about bigger quotients than metabelian quotients? And unfortunately, the answer is no. There is example of group bubbles of a group that is finitely presented, soluble, such that its maximal, that it has a quotient that is not metabelian, a bigger one, but it's not finitely presented. Actually, Abel's example is of a group that is S-arithmetic group. It can be realized as a group of matrices. And this matrix is up a triangle and have some entries on the main diagonal. So it becomes nilpotent of class 3 by abelian. It is finitely presented, but its center is not finitely generated. And because of that property, the quotient of G over the center is not finitely presented, and this quotient turns out to be nilpotent of class 2 by abelian. So you just relaxed a bit more. Here you say you find the quotient that is not abelian by abelian, it's nilpotent of class 2 by abelian, and already this theorem breaks, which tells you that actually metabelian groups are something very, very special. Now I'm going to move to Lie algebras. And the stuff I'm going to talk about is taken from two papers of Roger Bryant and John Groves. Roger Bryant is a specialist in Lie algebras and John Groves is a specialist in group theory. They joined forces and actually they classified all finitely presented metabelian Lie algebras. So in the following setting, all Lie algebras over a field K K-bar is going to be the algebraic closure of the field. And we can see the short exact sequence of Lie algebras ALQ. Here N, Q are abelian and L is finitely generated. We use the following notation. U of Q is the universal enveloping algebra of Q. And we view module, right module, over this universal enveloping algebra via the obvious action. When we consider groups, the obvious action was conjugation. When we consider Lie algebras, the obvious action is the joint action. This means that when we take element A from the bottom A and Q from the top Q, the action is the bracket, the action of Q on A is the bracket AB, where B is a preimage of Q in L. And some of the previous arguments were here. Our object Q is finitely presented in the category of Lie algebra because it's abelian and finitely generated. And this forces A to be finitely generated as a module over this commutative ring. The universal enveloping algebra of a finitely generated abelian Lie algebra is an obviously commutative polynomial ring. And as a such ring, it's Noetherian. And Bryant and Groves classified all finitely presented Lie algebras L with this metabelian Lie algebras L. And they proved that actually something similar to the group case happens. The finite presentation depends only on the structure of A as a module over UQ, the universal enveloping algebra, but does not depend on the type of the extension. I've written down two examples that we can see in details a bit later on, but we're going to study in more details these examples later, but we have Q abelian with two generators. We have a basis X and Y as a vector space over the basic field K. Here we don't assume anything for the field K, and we take A for a while. And we take A to be the polynomial ring Kx on one variable x. And I have to tell you what is the joint action of x and y on this commutative ring. And x, x by multiplication with x, and y, x as multiplication with x to the n. So this is the joint action of Q and A. And it turned out that when n is odds, the L is not finitely presented. If n is even, but the characteristic of the field is not 2, then L is finitely presented. But if the characteristic is 2, then L is not finitely presented. By now it looks a bit mysterious why this happens, but I'm going to explain you the Bryant Groff's criterion and then discuss this example in details to give you a kind of a flavor what goes on. So we need a bit of notations. Here we consider the formal polynomial series in one variable, t, but now the coefficients are not going to be in k, they're going to be in k bar, which is the algebraic closure of k. And as well, we consider the field of fractions of this ring. Then here we take a more general approach. We take, Q continues to be finite dimensional abeliany algebra. And we consider all homomorphisms from Q to the field of fraction. What homomorphisms? We think of homomorphism as vector spaces. So we consider all linear maps from Q to the field of fractions and call this set as gamma 1 of Q. And then we consider all linear maps from Q to the ring of the formal power series, and this is called gamma 0 of Q. So we view them as vector spaces over the basic field K and consider the quotient. The quotient is going to be a vector space, gamma 1 Q over gamma 0 Q. And we write bracket sky for the image of an element chi from gamma 1 in this quotient space. Okay. Now, remembering what is chi? Chi is just a linear map. It's a linear map from Q to the field of fractions. And by the universal property of the U of K, which is the universal n-topic algebra in our case is a polynomial ring, it extends in a unique way to algebra homomorphism. And now if we take a right UQ module, we consider some invariant called delta 1 QM. You consider all maps from gamma 1 Q, all linear maps in gamma 1 Q, such that the unique algebraic extension head chi applied on the annihilator of UQ in M is 0. And finally, we can define the Bryant-Groff's invariant. You consider all classes of characters of linear maps chi such that chi belongs to delta 1. So this is a some subset of the vectors of the quotient vector space gamma 1 over gamma 0. And finally, I can tell you what is the Bryant-Groff's criterion. So we have L, a finitely generated Lie algebra with a abelian ideal A, and here Q is the quotient L over A, and for a while it's only finite dimensional, so it's a bit more general than the previous notation. And the theorem states that the following three criteria conditions are equivalent. First, L is finitely presented. Secondly, the exterior square of A is finitely generated as a module over UQ, which is the universal n-topic algebra. And this is done via the diagonal action. And the third property is that the tensor square array is finitely generated over UK by the diagonal edge. Here at the bottom, I've written explicitly what is the diagonal action. It's the only natural action then that you can have. Actually, it is induced by the co-multiplication if you think in UQ as an example of a Hopf algebra. And in the particular case, when Q is abelian, actually, these three equivalent conditions from above, they turn out equivalent to a property about the Bryant-Groves invariant. So if you take two elements of the invariant, the Bryant-Groves invariant delta, that are antipodal in the sense that if you sum the class of phi 1 with the class of phi 2, which is by definition is the class of the sum, and if it happens to be the class of the zero map, then both classes of phi 1 and phi 2 are zero. Basically, it has delta cannot have non-trivial antipodal points. So it starts with similar to the Strebel criterion, though in a completely different category, in the category of the Lie algebras. So let us see an example. We go back to that example. I've stated it in a previous slide, but I'm going just to run the criterion of Bryant and Groves to give you kind of a feeling how it's applied. Here, our Lie algebra Q is abelian. It's two-dimensional over K. It has a basis as a vector space X and Y. A is the polynomial ring KX. The action of Y is multiplication by X to the N. Then the annihilator of the UK over A is the ideal generated by Y minus X to the N. So if I take an element from the Bieri Groves invariant delta, then it is what? This is an element of some quotient vector space, and it's represented by chi, where chi is a linear map. And its extension has the property that it should annihilate the annihilator of UK in A, which is this ideal generated by Y minus X to the N. And written down again, gamma 1 and gamma 0, if somebody has forgotten what they are. They're just linear maps from Q to some other vector spaces. One is a field of fraction, and the other is the ring of the power series. And now what this means that the head chi annihilates the annihilator, it means that it's zero over the generator, which is y minus x to the n, which is the same as saying that x to y is x to x to the n. So what happens here if n is odd? I can take this condition xy equals to x applied to x to the n. And this would imply that the same holds when chi is substituted with minus chi, because n is odd. And then this tells you that minus chi represents an element of delta as well. So this gives you a way of producing antipodal points. You should be sure that delta has a non-trivial element, but it's obvious because you can take this character below. Chi x is t inverse and chi y is t to minus n. So this way we produce antipodal non-zero elements, so L is not finitely presented. And now when n is even and the characteristic is known too, then you want to apply the criterion. You take two elements of delta, which are antipodal. So we take the elements, the class of chi 1 and the class of chi 2, and we want their sum to be an element that's equal to the class of 0. Because when delta, we know that chi1 of y is chi1 x to the n, and chi2 of y is chi2 x to the n. And because the sum is a trivial class, then you know that the sum of chi1 and chi2 applied to x and to y gives you an elements alpha and beta that the elements of the power series ring. And then you do a very simple calculation. You write A for chi1 of x, and then you write beta as a to the n plus alpha minus a to the n, open the brackets, use binomial coefficients, and you get one polynomial with integral coefficients. And then when the characteristic is not 2, we can divide by 2. And it tells you that we have an element from here, from the big, from the filter fraction, which is algebraic, which is actually integral over the ring of power series. And this forces then this element to be in the power series. And from there, you get easily that all elements considered are there. You get that chi1x, chi2x are here, chi1y, chi2 are here. So these two classes are the trivial ones. So that simple calculation tells you that delta does not contain antipodal non-zero elements when the characteristic of the basic field is not 2. So your Lie algebra L is finitely presented. And finally, when the characteristic is 2, I mean, because in characteristic 2, if you sum one class of a linear map chi with itself, you get the class of t two times the same, but in characteristic 2, this is equal to 0. Okay, so this way you easily produce antipodal non-zero elements, so your Lie algebra is not finitely presented. I mean, what is important here, that there exists a class of element, there is an element of delta that is non-zero. And this is equivalent with A is not finite dimensional as a vector space, which is our case. Okay, I mean, I've given you the Bryant-Grosch criterion and some example how it's applied. In general, it can be very complicated. And the complication is that the structure of A as a UK module can be very complicated. It might be very difficult to calculate this delta, if at all possible to calculate. Now, I want to briefly compare the Lie algebra case with groups. First of all, the Lie algebra case does not use geometric methods. Groups act on spaces, Lie algebras don't act in spaces. We're talking about metabelian Lie algebras, not to Lie algebras that are associated to Lie groups. So, I mean, unfortunately, we don't have any geometric methods here. And geometry was really, really important when you study finite presentability for groups. But there is a similarity because the way the criterion of Bryant-Grosch is proved is use quite a lot of evaluation theory from commutative algebra. And the reason for this, we work with metabelian objects, and the metabelian object naturally has the bottom, has a structure as a module over the top. So getting commutative algebra methods here is not a surprise. Then, when I defined the Bieri-Strebel criterion, it was about non-antipodal points, but there were no exterior powers, no squares. But still, they appear there in some way. So I want to explain you the following. If A, G, and Q is a short exact sequence of groups, then you can look at the bottom A and view it as a module over Q, but you can think of it as well as just an abelian, additive abelian group. And the finite presentability of G implies that this second homology of A with coefficients in Z is actually finitely generated as a module over Q. The action of Q is induced by the action of Q on A by conjugation and gives you an action on the exterior square, and the action is the natural one, which is the diagonal one. And the diagonal one for groups comes from the co-multiplication if you think of the group algebra as a Hopf algebra, but it's the natural one, Qx on both coordinates simultaneously. And surprisingly here, the final generation over Q of the exterior power proves the same from tensor power. But this property is not sufficiently strong to imply finite presentation. Okay. But what we've seen by the Bryant-Groves criterion, then if we move to the language of Lie algebras and we have a short exact sequence of Lie algebras, which is extension by the abelian Lie algebras A and Q, then the finite presentability of L is equivalent to the finite generation of the exterior square of A as a UQ module by the diagonal action. So it's kind of, you can ask why for groups finite generation of exterior square is not enough, and for Lie algebras it's enough. And the main reason is that because when you work in the group case, you work over modules over ZQ, and the basic ring is the ring event if integers. But when we work with, in the Lie case, we work with Lie algebras over fields. So here the basic ring is a field, and that messes up things and makes them different. And for example, there is one open problem for finitely presented Lie algebras. I told you that metabelian quotients of finitely presented groups without free non-cyclic subgroups are always finitely presented. And you can ask the same question about Lie algebras. And this is an open problem. I spent a lot of time about this, thinking about this, and I talked to John Groves and we tried it together and it didn't work by now. And it looks complicated. And now we move to restrictly algebras. Well, people view restricted Lie algebras as an object some way between Lie algebras and groups. So once we have theories that classify finite presentability of metabelian objects in the category of groups and Lie algebras, you can ask whether you can do the same for restricted Lie algebras. First, I put here the general definition of a restricted Lie algebras. I'm not going to read it, but this is a Lie algebras over a field, and this field now has a positive characteristic P, and there is a special operation called P operation, which looks like taking a P power, and it satisfies the following three conditions. You know how it respects multiplication by scour, how it respects sum, and how it respects bracket when one of the coordinates is a P power. And in the category of restricted Lie algebras, a homomorphism is a homomorphism of Lie algebras that preserves as well the structure, the P structure, the structure of P powers. And ideals are ordinary ideals that are closed under the P operation. Now, in the category of restricted Lie algebra, we have universal algebra. Restricted universal F-Wilking algebra, which is constructed in the following way. You think of your restricted Lie algebra and forget about the P operation and construct its universal enveloping algebra as a Lie algebra. And then you consider the two-sided ideal generated by the P power of element minus, and then you take L and take its P power as an element of universal Mvbilling algebra. Then this gives you a two-sided ideal J, and then the quotient UL over J is the restricted universal enveloping algebra. And now in the last part of the talk, and I'll try to hurry a bit to finish in time, but I'm going to present some new results that were done with the PhD students. And then we classified all finitely presented metabelian restricted Lie algebra. We work in the following setting. We have restricted Lie algebra L, which is extension of A by Q. The first thing that should be noted that the extension here is split. We don't work with just a short exact sequence. It's too general. We take a split extension. And NQ are restricted Lie algebras. And we view A as a module over the restricted universal empirical algebra of Q by that obvious joint action. And again, this is a very nice, this is a quotient of a finitely generated polynomial ring over the basic field, it's a Noetherian ring. And in this context, we consider AP to the I, which is the subvector space of A generated by all elements that are P to the I power. We define P to the I power by iterating, implying many times P powers. And then we define one map, phi I, from two consecutive quotients of this sequence. AP to the I gives you a filtration of A. And then you get this map that sends a representative, a class with representative A to a class of representative A to the P power of A. Now, this map is not in general a linear map, it's going to be a P semi-linear map. It preserves sums, but if you take scours, a scour gets out as a P power. And we consider A over A to the P, the P powers in A. And in these settings, what we have, this is always finitely generated module over the restricted universal algebra of Q by the joint action. And we consider the exterior power of this module, but this exterior power over K, view it as a right module over the universal restricted algebra of Q by the diagonal action, which is the same diagonal action you have in the case of ordinary algebras. So I can tell you the main criteria now. I've already told you that we are not in the we don't just have a short exact sequence. The first restriction is we have a split extension. The second restriction is that our field should be perfect. Okay, this means that every element of a K is some P power. And then under these conditions, L is finitely presented if and only if we have three conditions. The first one is that A over the A to the P, which are the P powers, is finitely generated as a model over the restricted universal algebra. The exterior power of the same module is finitely generated as a model over the restricted universal algebra by the diagonal action. And then we define some semilinear maps phi I. For every I, we want that the dimension of the kernel is a finite number. And for a sufficiently big I, it becomes zero. So these three conditions are equivalent with L is finitely presented in the category of restrictedly algebras. We didn't attempt the non-split case because it's technically very complicated. And we used partially homological methods because actually what happened is why this condition here appeared, because for example, A over A to the P powers, is naturally isomorphic to the first homology, restricted homology of A with coefficients in K, which is tor 1 of the associated ring U res A, the universal restricted algebra of A, with trivial coefficients on both coordinates. And why the external power appears? Because it naturally embeds in the second restricted homology group, which is H2 res AK, which is what tor in dimension 2 of the associative ring U res A with two coefficients K. I mean, differently from the group case when there is an isomorphism between exterior powers, here we don't have isomorphism, but natural embedding. And And there's some corollaries of this, which are the following. First of all, when the characteristic is bigger than 2, then there is a finitely presented metabelian restrictedly algebra that has a restrictedly algebra quotient that is not finitely presented. Okay, something like this doesn't happen for Lie algebras, ordinary ones. Now, if the characteristic is 2 and we have the split extension, then the criterion, we have a split extension, you will know that L is finitely presented. The criterion I gave you in the previous slides tells you that implies that A over A to the P is actually finitely dimensional because it requires then the use of the Bryant-Groves criterion. And in that case, once this is finite dimensional, every restrictedly algebra quotient of L is finitely presented. So here things start behaving differently compared to the ordinary algebras. And then you can also, okay, things are different when we look at quotients of restrictedly algebra. What about embedding problems? We proved that finitely generated metabelian restrictedly algebra does not necessarily embed in a finitely presented split metabelian restrictedly algebra. And such kind of result is wrong if you go to the category of ordinary Lie algebras when the characteristic P is bigger than 2. There is an old paper by Gilbert Bamswak when he proved that you can always embed finitely generated metabelian, ordinary metabelian Lie algebra in a finitely presented one, provided the characteristic is bigger than 2. And it's interesting that this paper was published much before Bryant-Groves criterion existed, much before Bieri-Strebel theory existed. And he uses methods from commutative algebra and techniques from localization to do this. And just final remarks. I mean, I told you what happens in 3 categories, in the category of groups, in the category of ordinary Lie algebras, in the category of restricted Lie algebras. But there is more, there is a similar theory developed in the category of finitely presented metabelian proppy groups. But I didn't talk about this, but this theory was developed by Jeremy King. Now, in general, I wanted to point out that very little is known about restricted Lie algebras or for Lie algebras for finite presentability. But Bieri-Strebel theory that started with their paper in the 80s actually has grown up in a subfield of geometric group theory, because they later on developed a more general sigma invariant that applies for any finitely generated group. Then they defined more general higher dimensional invariants that can be defined for groups of homotopical type Fn. And I just here stated one list of more than 30 people that work on sigma theory, on applications of sigma theory in geometric group theory. And this list excludes people that work on tropical geometry. So the stuff that started just with metabelian groups 40 years ago just happened to grow enormously. But somehow for Lie algebras and now for restricted Lie algebras, we know very little. For example, there is no known way of generalizing the Bryant-Groves invariant for more general Lie algebras. And I tried to work on this. I spoke to John Groves, I spoke to Conchita Martinez Perez. We tried to find some more general way of doing this Bryant-Groves invariant that applies for bigger class of Lie algebras, but unfortunately we haven't succeeded in this. Thank you very much for your attention.
You thank us, but we want to thank you for the nice talk. Do you have any question? Okay.
Thank you very much, Desi. May I speak?
Thank you for your patience.
Do you have any questions or comments?
Yeah, I do.
Okay.
Let me raise my hand officially. Okay. hi, Bessie. Thank you very much for this beautiful talk. I have two questions for you. First question, what's the name of your dog?
Actually, the dog that was barking was the neighbor's, but I have a dog and her name is Luna.
Okay, thank you. Second question. Coming from, I dealt with finally presented groups from another point of view, right? From computational group theory point of view. So this beautiful theory is from another angle. It's more existential proofs. So I'm just wondering if there are examples of this Bieri Strebel theory, examples of these theorems of the real presentation, if a group is finally presented, what can you give the real presentation, like in the theorem when G-G second is finally presented? Are there any
if you can, I'm not sure whether you can calculate whether it's computational to do the sigma invariant. If you know the sigma invariant, you can compute a finite presentation explicitly. If you can calculate the sigma invariant, and to calculate the sigma invariant means to calculate some value. You have to understand the annihilate, you have to understand the action of Q and A, you have to calculate the annihilator of ZQ on its action on A. So you take the ZQ over the annihilator, it's a ring. You have to be able to calculate its valuations with going to R infinity, real valuations. And to calculate this, you depend on something which is called Newton polygon.
Newton what?
Newton polygon. You have to take all elements and take their minimal polynomials and write down, because in a Q, so in some Rn, and then you have to take the convex hull of the points that appear in your relation, and you do something with them. But whether this is calculatable, I'm not sure. I mean, this boils down to what is done in Brian Grove's paper. I think they prove that it's a rationally defined polyhedron, so probably this is calculatable.
I see. Okay.
And then there is a very old essay by Strebel that was written around the time, like a few years after the first paper on the subject appears, and he gives an example, very concrete example, when the invariant is given explicitly, and then he says, using the theory and the calculations in the first paper, we have that huge presentation. But in practice, normally you get presentation that are much smaller. I think things are calculatable. But what is hidden behind is exactly that stuff that you sigma invariant, the complement of the sigma invariant is a rationally defined polyhedron. And this rational defined polyhedron is very useful for people in tropical geometry. I mean, if you open MathSciNet and look at that paper of Bryant and Groves, actually it has more citations than the original paper of Bieri Strebel, because it has a lot of application. The fact that they prove what is the structure of the complement of sigma.
Okay, thank you very
but
much.
But the fact that it's computational, I'm not sure that there is a program that computes it. And I talked once, there is a famous guy in Berkeley who works with tropical geometry, but I'm not good in names. And he's very interested in this, but people in tropical geometry, what explains to me is that they work over fields, and Bieri Strebel invariant is over set, which is actually Bieri Strebel invariant in the version original they do is much more complicated.
Yeah, I have to look at the paper of Bryant and Groves, because I know these names from for a very long time. They were actually, I actually used some results a long time ago of those two, and they were actually calculating some identities. I was dealing at that time with Hannah Neumann's book, Varieties of Groups, and they had some results in this area. Now I see it from another angle, Lie algebra and stuff, which is very interesting. Okay.
Somehow for Lie algebras, I mean, my talk is more kind of motivation to say, I mean, I strongly believe there is much more to the Lie algebra case, but I don't know what it is actually. Mm-hmm. I mean, it would be wonderful to find the Bryant-Grof's invariant generalizes for much bigger class of Lie algebras. But the main, I didn't talk about the general sigma invariant, it has kind of geometric flavor. And because for Lie algebras, you lose the geometry at all.
Maybe, so maybe you'll talk again and give us this geometrical flavor. That would be interesting.
But the point is, there is no obvious way to generalize. I spent time on this, I talked to people, and nobody knows how to get the Lie algebra version. And the starting point of the sigma theory is that if you take a line, one has two ends. And for Lie algebras, if you try to see similarity about the group in Lie algebras, the product becomes sum, and then plus goes to minus. That's the antipodality. But it's not clear what to do with this. When you have a line, you cut it into a real line, you cut it in two rays in both directions. And that's the starting point of sigma theory. You have some geometry, you have directions. With Lie algebras, it's not clear at all what to do. And second, even for Lie algebras, there is very little known. If you look at the restricted Lie algebras, you realize that, I mean, there is very, very little study about restricted Lie algebra. I was kind of a shock. Even if you study homological properties of restricted Lie algebras, there is very, very little.
May I ask a naive question?
Okay. Now
you say you made some big difference between Lie algebras and your stuff, but Lie algebras have Lie groups, which are also groups, and also Lie algebras have Weyl groups, the group of reflections. So there is a lot of groups related to Lie algebras. There should be some connection with what you're doing.
Yeah.
Because you say you lose geometry, but how you lose geometry when you have a Lie group? It is geometrical after all.
The point is, you talk about metabelian Lie algebras. There is nothing geometric about them. I mean, there is a... that's the whole point. I mean, you have a connection between Lie algebras and Lie groups. Okay, but then your Lie algebras become very specific Lie algebras. And here, I mean, my background, I start with soluble objects. Like my dream would be, okay, classify all finitely presented soluble groups. This is open, nobody, I mean, when Bieri Strebel invariant came in the first theory, people would thought, oh, in 10 years, there will be huge theory about classifying all finitely presented soluble groups. And now it's very, very clear, it's out of hand, it's impossible, it's very, very difficult. I mean, there is no classification of finite presentability of nilpotent by a billion groups. You know, metabelian groups are a billion by a billion, and there is a beautiful theory, and it very nicely mixes methods from algebraic topology with algebraic calculation. Half of the paper of Bieri Strebel is basic algebraic topology, and the other half is some done by hand calculations with groups, but done in a very clever way because you have this invariant in the middle that makes things easy or easier. But then you say, okay, that works for a billion by a billion. And you just extend a bit more. You say, I want to classify nilpotent of class 2 metabelian by a billion. You just want a billion goes to nilpotent of class 2, but it is at the bottom. So it's not supposed to be finitely generated as a group, but it's acted on top of some abelian group. And then all of a sudden it becomes completely different, very difficult, and there is no general theory about this. There's some results they talk about S arithmetic groups. If you have nilpotent by abelian S arithmetic groups, which are right special class of matrix groups, then there is a book written about this that takes main ideas of Bieri Strebel and invariants, go through this, go from a different category when, I mean, you have to do more complicated things. You go through Lie algebras because groups are more difficult than Lie algebras. You did you do things with Lie algebras and you do very nice classification, but this is a very particular class of groups. Nilpotent by abelian S-arithmetic groups were resolved by Hebert Adels. And as I said, it's not even a paper, it's a book. I don't remember how many pages, but at least 150, right? So in a particular classes of groups, when you have a nice link between geometry and algebra, you can get some results. But kind of, if you want to say only nilpotent by abelian, nobody has a clue. I mean, even people tried, like John Groves and Chris Brooks, they have a series of papers talking about abelian by nilpotent. It was 20 years ago. For a while, they were claiming they're close to have a classification, but I haven't seen a classification. They have some results, they have nice results, they have some restrictions, but there is no classification, it becomes difficult. So there is something very, very special about metabelian objects in all these categories. That's why we get some nice results and you can kind of see what it is, what is finite presentability. But outside, it's complicated. And as well, even in our case, we've done only the split extension. Though, I mean, I have a PhD student that is going to work with restricted Lie algebras. I'm not going to ask him to do the non-split case. I think it's going to be very nasty and pleasant calculation to deal with the non-split case. He's going to look at high dimensional versions of finite presentation. There is something called homological type FPN. Well, I mean, I'm trying to explain what my point of view on the subject is, but generally I'll be very happy to see people working more on Lie algebras and restricted Lie algebra, because I mean, it's natural to ask about finite presentability of those objects, but actually people that do algebras normally don't ask about finite presentability in terms of generators and relators. Right? They talk about presentation of them of presentations as a matrix maps from your object to matrices, but they don't talk about presentation in terms of generators and relations.
By the way, do you know that there is such a subject called quantum groups?
Which are quantum groups are not groups, right?
No, 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 of course not. I'm not saying that they are groups, but they are intimately related to the algebras, and they are presentable, the quantum groups, in terms of relations. They are, especially those which are so-called matrix quantum groups. So there is some connection to what you are saying.
Okay, yeah, I'm not specialist on this, I
can. I'm thinking about Plotkin, you know, father and son, more specifically about the son, Zhenya Plotkin. He has some results about, well, presentations and Lie algebras as well. So I'm not quite sure if he is quite in the area, but you can just Google it and see what he has done recently. He is in Israel and he works with plenty of people there. Yee Plotkin, Eugene.
I think I looked through some of his stuff, and then he cites cooking as well, because the person who did a bit of work on restricted Lie algebra freelance was cooking many years ago. Mm-hmm. But I mean, my point of view is homological. So what, for example, Brian Groff's paper, it doesn't use anything about homology. And they try to avoid any homology, though some of the reasoning there can be done in a homological way. Right?
Yeah.
But what I was surprised when I was checking the literature, I mean, very little is known about the homology of restricted Lie algebra. I mean, if you look in the literature, there is a lot of stuff about homology of Lie algebras, and restricted Lie algebra that is blank.
I have a naive question. Here you speak about the groups in the Lie algebras, they are finitely presented if you consider this as Lie algebras, not as groups. But you can consider also such things if you work in the class of metabelian objects. This is possible to find the relations, for example, in the metabelian, case, and then to leave them to the to the free object.
I don't see a link. Now I understood the question, but you see, what goes wrong with the metabelian? I mean, if you talk about classical finite presentation, the difficulty to be finitely, a metabelian group to be finitely presented is that normally, if you write your the first presentation you think of, normally it's infinitely generated because you need infinitely many commutators. Okay, I've never seen link between those, but I kind of cannot imagine why there should be link, because the relatively free, the free metabelian object, which is the free in the category of metabelian groups, it's not finitely presented as an ordinary group. So I don't see how there should be lifting from, these are different problems, right? I don't see why there should be link between them, okay?
I know, but then the finite presentability, this should be easier to solve than in the general case. So,
may I make a comment on Daniela's first question? It's a very general comment from, it's so general that I should say it's outside the whole of algebra, that general. So, if you want to calculate, to compute finite presentations, which are a sort of finite account of your algebraic system, then you first have to come up with some finite account to start from, to feed into your algorithm, yeah? And it very much depends on what sort of finite account you have for the system that you want to calculate the finite presentation for. So in general, it may be just a formalized proof that the system is in the particular class for which your algorithm is supposed to work. So, and if this proof has something non-constructive in it, of course, this knotty point in the proof will have a reflection on the outcome of the finite presentation. But maybe there are methods, I don't know. Maybe in algebra there are even formalized languages which allow you to carry out the calculation if, you start from some well understood objects and apply standard operations like, you know, products, factorizations and the like on them. And then you can have a more restrictive language and probably more algorithms. So it very much depends on how you look at your question, how you formalize your question about computing presentation. Because presentability is actually one special way of finitely describing things. And you have to start from another one.
Okay.
Thanks.
Some other questions? And I think there are some examples of solvable groups and solvable algebras where the word problem is not solvable. What happens with the metabelian groups and algebras?
I mean, I don't know. I haven't thought about this.
Okay.
Our word problem for metabelian should be known. Mm.
I think so. Yeah.
No, the word problem for metabelian groups is easy. It was like,
because they're residually finite. Metabelian
groups are
residually finite. That's why. I mean, this is for groups. I don't know what is known about for Lie algebras, because I didn't. I mean, I studied finite presentability. Actually, I didn't mention this, but for these objects, there is a homological property called FP2, which is equivalent to finite presentability. But I decided that there is no need to introduce it, because finite presentability is much easier to describe. But metabelian groups are residually finite, so the word problem is known.
Okay, thank you. Some other questions? Okay, we made a record because 1 hour and 30 minutes of seminar.
Yeah, I have a question to you, Dvesku, if I may.
Yeah, sure.
I don't know why I think that you have a very important birthday this year. Am I right? And when is that going to be?
Okay, my next birthday, this is December 10th, and when I was 71.
Oh, I missed it. Okay, congratulations then.
Okay, thank you. Dvesku
turns 70 in December. Yeah.
10th of December, 10th.
10th of December, all right. Yeah. I missed it then. Okay.
Okay, it's... Okay, if there are no other questions, let's thank Jesse once again. And the next talk, it will be a little bit later, 4:30 Bulgarian time. And it will be a joint meeting with the Department of Analysis, Geometry and Topology. And the speaker will be Yudmila Kamenova. She's a Bulgarian, but she works in the States. You can see the information on the whole page of the seminar, and we also sent it to the people in our list. Okay. Thank you.
Shall I stop recording now?
Yes, sure.